One more flash talk, and our next presenter is Juliana White. She's a program manager for CGIAR research program on climate change, agriculture, and food security. I'll let her just tell us what that acronym stands for, because I don't have it in my notes. Previously, she lived in Niger and Ghana, where she worked for the Peace Corps, CARE International, and USAID. She's interested in sustainability from local to international scale. Juliana?
Thank you. So I'm going to skip. So CCASH, the CGIAR research program, what do? We're a group of three people here at the University of Vermont who work on low emissions development and agriculture. And what low emissions development is, we do research, we do engagement to develop agricultural options that decrease greenhouse gas emissions and increase carbon sequestration. So we work at multiple levels. So at an international level, we work with climate financiers to develop options for agriculture. We think of climate finance and energy and transportation, but also in agriculture. We work with national negotiators who attend the Paris Agreement to provide them the science and data they need to develop national contributions to the Paris Agreement. We work with smallholder farmers on dairy development to make sure that they increase food loss and waste in the dairy value chain. And we work with rice farmers to decrease all important methane emissions that Tad brought up earlier. So I'm going to skip to telling you why we need to communicate, because I think that's been covered very well. What also has been covered today is how do we get from the science to the impact? And Tad spoke about, Jamie spoke about, Bridget spoke about, how do we get there? At CCAS, our climate change, agriculture and food security project, we talk about it like as an impact pathway. So define your impact, and what are the steps that we need to get there? And important in that is the stakeholders. So our impact, we need to impact farmers. But in order to impact farmers, we have to impact policymakers and extension agents and development organizations along the way. I have a note from here. You know, the crux of this is that we all have the science to do this, and we all can envision it, but it just takes time and energy to flesh out those steps, to develop the key messages to meet the next users that you want to meet. So here's the case study. So three steps that I'm going to talk about here. The first one is we have this nutrient management, which is like fertilizer management technology, and we have optical sensors that were developed in Oklahoma State in the 90s. Farmers in Canada, the U.S., and Europe have been using these for a long time. But we know that fertilizer use has grown quickly in countries around the world, and probably many of us have heard that fertilizer overuse is a problem in some countries, in India and China, but it's actually in many countries. So we have scientists in India who are thinking, well, how can we use this optical sensor technology to, in India, we have a different crops, we have a different ecosystem, we have different farmers. So they published a paper. That's what scientists, that's what we think of, kind of old school, that's what we do. But then the next steps are to bring it to policymakers, as Jamie said, and we use some of the same tools. We use briefs that aim for policymakers, I'm going to look at my screen here, at policymakers and investors. And we use feasibility analyses to say, okay, this worked in Oklahoma, and it works in India, and it works in Mexico. How can it work in your different regions? So we really need to bring it to a regional level. And we also need to talk about, in this last one, where it talks about climate smart villages, we need to test things out and get farmers using the materials, not just at research stations, not just in here, but and talk about it in their regions. So that's where we reach out to development organizations, other people that work on the ground. And when I say development organizations, I also mean not international development organizations, but extension organizations, groups of farmers, cooperatives, like that. So we move on to the end users, and these are our farmers. And what's exciting about looking at innovation and using it in different places is that farmers innovate. You have entrepreneurs everywhere in the world. So while an individual farmer might not purchase an optical sensor in India, a smart young son of a farmer might purchase an optical sensor and rent out the use of that to different farmers around. So we try to have the kind of local technology around that. We have very clear kind of communication messages and visuals that describe to farmers what they can use, not the kind of the pieces that were in science, but laid out to exactly what we need. And what is our impact? Well, for farmers, their motivation is increased profitability and increased production. And for us, we're getting that increased food security and livelihoods that the farmers have, and we're contributing to decreased nitrous oxide emissions and water pollution.